they stop their food pantry. There's a lot of food insecure people who live on campus, and it would be incredibly helpful if we can make sure their shelves are stocked so that hungry people can feed. So keep an eye out for announcements from the social ministry team, and there's already a table and a sign and all sorts of stuff. So as you head into the Easter breakfast following the service in Luther Hall, I invite you to keep an eye out for the hungry people in our wider community as well. Also, mark your calendars for Sunday, April 21st, the Adult Education Day. We'll be featuring a video by ecologist Doug Talaney. And after, there'll be an extended coffee hour, I believe, during which the prayer team is going to host some Earth Day events. So I hope that you are prepared and excited for Earth Day as we care for the creation that God has made and that we all share. Later on, when it comes time for the communion portion of our liturgy, there are instructions for how we celebrate here at Emmanuel, but the long and short of it is that we celebrate pilgrim style, so we'll invite you to come forward at the direction of the usher, forming a line in the center aisle. We'll start with the pulpit side and move afterwards to the organ side, and eventually, last but not least, to the choir. As you can come forward to receive the body and blood of Christ, truly present in the bread and wine that we have to offer. If you need to be served where you are seated, just let an usher know. We're more than happy to do that. If you need gluten-free or alcohol-free options, we have those. Just let us know. And as always, we practice an open table here at Emmanuel because we recognize that this table, it's not ours. It belongs to God. And no one is turned away from God's grace. So I hope you hear this word of invitation, that if you hunger and thirst for the grace of God in this sacrament, you are welcome here. Is there anything else we want to lift up before God and one another? Yes, Valerie.
I just wanted to say that Connie Ross, a couple weeks ago, brought in a wonderful booklet about the 50th anniversary of Emmanuel. It has the early history and a lot of great pictures, early ministers and such, and I brought it back to, but I also made some copies and set them on the table out there if anyone wants to grab them. And if they all get taken, I can print some more because I work at a print house.
Well, a good day to reflect on the history of Emmanuel as we tell the story of the story that unites us as a community of faith. So thank you, Valerie. Not seeing any other hands, I do want some help, especially if there's any young people in the congregation this morning, to come forward. I need some help handing out things that will make this service as loud as we possibly can. So during Lent, which comes right before Easter, we don't say the word Alleluia much. In fact, we don't really say it at all. We fast from the Alleluia. Do you know what the word Alleluia means? I know it's Hebrew, and we don't translate it. We just sort of say it and assume everyone knows what it means. It means praise the Lord, which is a pretty good thing, I think. It's not something that we sing during Lent or say during Lent, so when we start saying it again during Easter, it's kind of a big deal. So I want your help in making this service as loud as we possibly can. Every time you hear the word Alleluia, I want you to make some noise. And we've got more noisemakers here than we have you folks. So if you are interested in taking some of these around and giving them to anyone who wants them, I could really use your help. Because I don't think that this is something that, you know, just people of a certain age or younger should participate in. I think we should all get to be loud and obnoxious. What do you think? At least I love being loud and obnoxious. So if you want to grab one of these and grab a few extras. And if any of you want one of these, I want to see. celebration, and it should echo with the joy of the resurrection this morning. And hopefully, it will. So I invite you all to stand as you are able, as we come before God, giving thanks for the gift of baptism. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the wellspring of grace, our Easter and our joy.
Amen.
Look, here is water.
Here is the water of life. Hallelujah.
Immersed in the promises of baptism, let us give thanks for what God has done for us. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your voice thundered over the deep, and water became the essence of life. Adam and Eve beheld Eden's verdant rivers. The ark carried your creation through the flood into a new day. Miriam led the dancing as your people passed through the sea into freedom's land. In a desert pool, the Ethiopian official entered your boundless baptismal life. Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life. Hallelujah.
At the river, your beloved son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you opened the floodgates of your reconciling love, freeing us to live as Easter people. Let us rejoice with glad hearts, giving honor and praise to you through the risen Christ, our source of living water, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Let us pray. O God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, and by his glorious resurrection you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Reading from Acts. Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all of the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. A reading from 1 Corinthians. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. Word of God, word of life.
Holy Gospel according to St. Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so they might go and anoint Jesus' body. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there's the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Jesus didn't deserve how he got treated. That's not controversial, right? Like, that's kind of the whole point of the story we tell this morning as we celebrate the feast of the resurrection. We talk about how God brings unexpected joy and boundless grace, breaking open the tomb to bring all people this good news of great joy, that death has been defeated, that the power of sin has been undone. The kingdom of God is at hand, and all the world is being made new. Granted, none of the disciples really knew what it meant until that first Easter morning, and even then, it took them a while to wrap their heads around it. It begins with these women who find the tomb empty. They're the first to hear this message of hope that even death cannot silence, and sure, they don't go and tell their story right away. It takes them a minute to wrap their heads around what they've just heard and what they've just seen, that Jesus can't be found in the tomb because he's not dead anymore. He's been raised. And in fact, he's already on the road, on his way to bring the same promise of hope to everyone he encounters there. And truth be told, it's always a little weird to preach on Easter morning because after reading the gospel of our Lord, what more can I really offer? What more needs to be said than what Mark already did? Today we join Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome as witnesses to that empty tomb, experiencing anew the grace of our Lord that redeems the world. And I love the way Mark tells this story because he doesn't wrap it up in a neat little bow for us. It's a way of telling the gospel story that mirrors our lives and our world because it's messy, it's incomplete, and at times more than a little unsatisfying, with the final act still playing out. It's a story of Easter that makes room for all the uncertainty and trepidation of Maundy Thursday, all the grief and the pain and the terror of Good Friday. Which is good, I think. Because without the honesty of Good Friday, the hope of Easter rings hollow to my ears. We don't always do such a great job of framing the story of Easter. Jesus didn't deserve what happened to him, and that's kind of the point. That's what we mean when we say that Jesus died for our sins, right? We've all heard that once or twice over the years. I remember being told that as a kid, that Good Friday is called good because that's when Jesus died for our sins. He was innocent, but we are guilty. We are all sinners, after all. Jesus didn't deserve what was coming to him, but he took the bullet for us all. Jesus was innocent, but he suffered for my crimes, my transgressions, my sins. Jesus died for me, so I didn't have to go through all that. Now, the church calls this substitutionary atonement, and it makes a big deal of it theologically, but well, maybe I'm dabbling in some heresy this Easter morning, but speaking from the heart, framing the story of the Passion as stuff they did to Jesus so it wouldn't happen to me is messed up. Beyond being not especially good theology, it makes for a really upsetting reading of the story of Easter because it paints God as cruel, demanding suffering and death to slake his thirst for blood, and that's just not the God I find in the gospel. Jesus didn't deserve what was done to him. That's the point. No one deserves what was done to him. The world is cruel and unjust, and most of us just have to live with the fact that life isn't fair. But it should be. The world doesn't have to be like this, full of brokenness and suffering. This morning, we tell the story of God's justice at work. In the empty tomb, we witness the world not as it is, or even the world as it might be if it wasn't so chock full of the dinguses that run the place. In the empty tomb that Mary and Salome discover, we witness the world as God is making it to be, as God is redeeming it. Now, humanity never seems to tire of finding new and creative ways to pile injustice and suffering on one another, so Christ never tires of bringing healing. Christ makes it clear where God is to be found. Not on a throne or living in comfort in some palatial mansion, but on a cross, in a tomb. And soon, on the road to Galilee, in the places we don't expect God to be, when we're not even looking for her, we will find that God has gone ahead of us, proclaiming the good news of the resurrection to all people, starting with those who are burdened most by grief and pain and hardship. Today we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord, standing shoulder to shoulder with these women at the tomb, witnessing anew the grace of our God being poured out on a broken world. And this promise of new life is for the cosmos. It's for all creation. It's for wherever people are hurting and in need of hope. Wherever there is suffering and death, Christ is right there in the thick of it. Even when that means hanging on a cross alongside condemned criminals. Easter is a story that nobody gets left out of. No one is deemed unworthy of this gift of new and abundant life. No one is looked at by our God and said, "Everyone except for you, you don't deserve it." That might be how humanity sometimes talks about this story, but it is not the story we find in Mark's gospel. This is a story that includes all of creation, that encompasses every place of human sorrow and grief, just as it encompasses every moment of joy and jubilation. Easter is a reminder of the promise that you are beloved always, and that no matter what we face, God is with us, working through us and among us, to bring justice and peace to the world. Because no one deserves to be treated the way God was treated on the cross. And we are called to help make this world that God gives us a glimpse of this morning a reality. This is the gift of Easter, that this is not some far-off kingdom that we only look to after we die. This is the world as it can be today. Indeed, it's our work as a people of God, as a community of faith, to make this reality our daily reality, proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ for all the world in all that we do, proclaiming to all people that they are beloved and precious. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you. Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Holy God, we pray for the body of Christ, the church, where the church is persecuted, protected, where the church is privileged, granted humility, where the church is fractured, heal it. Guide us all to embody Christ's love in the world. God of grace, hear our prayer. Life-giving God, we pray for the earth, your good creation. Join our prayers with those of all creation. The dance of the flowering dogwood and cottonwood in the wind, the steady hum of the Missouri and Kansas rivers, the songs of the eastern bluebird and western meadowlark, that together all make proclaim Easter hope. God of grace, hear our prayer. Merciful God, we pray for all peoples and nations. Free oppressed communities from occupation, exploitation, and abuse. Teach leaders your way of justice. Raise up a spirit of compassion in the Kansas legislature and the Missouri General Assembly that they will protect rather than bully the most vulnerable people in their states. Empower peacemakers and all who work to end violence and strife. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Liberating God, we pray for people everywhere who long for good news. Roll away the stones that keep people from living with dignity and wholeness. Breathe new life and hope into people struggling to make it through each day. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Loving God, we pray for this community of faith and for your spirit in our midst. Feed us at your Easter table and fill us with your wisdom that we may serve and care for others. Rest your healing hand on all who are frail of body or spirit, especially Rick, Andre, Pat, Mylon, Bob, Naomi, Betty, Deanne, Suzanne, E.B., Carolyn, and those we name before you now, out loud or in our hearts. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Eternal God, we remember those who have gone before us in death, especially John Donne and all whose ministry in the arts inspired generations to faith. Renew our trust in your promises that we live with joyful courage and compassion. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen.
The peace of the risen Christ be with you always.
Share a sign of God's peace with one another.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Risen One, you call us to believe and bear fruit. May the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witnesses in the world through Jesus Christ, our true vine. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Son,
through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
God, remember us in your love and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The risen Christ is made known to us in the breaking.
Come, join the banquet of heaven at God's own table.
Thank you.
the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Shepherding God, you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love. Send us forth from this banquet to proclaim your goodness and share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend. Amen.
Christ is risen. Hallelujah. Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah. The God of resurrection power, the Christ of unending joy, and the Spirit of Easter hope bless you now and forever.